The webinar is part of the webinar series Driving First and First Bharat during COVID-19. This webinar is co-organized by Green Grid Foundation and Smart Cities India Expo. Now we have with us a very experienced speakers to share their thoughts and insight on this important topic. We have Madhusudan Anand, co-founder, CTO and data scientist from AMBI. Welcome, Madhi. We have Prarthana Bora. She is an India director for Clean Air Asia. Welcome, Prarthana. Divya Das, program management officer from UNEP. Divya, we welcome you here. Riya Majumdar Singhal, and she is a founder and CEO of EcoWare. Welcome, Riya. Dr. Ajay Nagpure, he is the head air pollution in WRI India. Welcome, Dr. Ajay. The session will be moderated by Ashish Sachdeva. He is a founder and president for Green Green Foundation. Welcome, Ashish, and thank you for your support. This is a 90-minute discussion, and attendees are requested to send their question through Q&A box. We will take the question towards the end of the webinar. So, Ashish, session is over to you. You can start now.
Sure. Thank you so much, Aarti, for the introduction. And firstly, thank you so much, all the eminent speakers, for joining in on time. Over the last few days when we have interacted, we were trying to build a platform wherein we can have a very diverse conversation and also at the same time a conversation and a discussion which is valuable for the people listening, because, you know, we understand right now we are being overwhelmed with the number of webinars happening globally, getting so many invitations. So the purpose is, how do we make a conversation different and valuable, and more importantly, action oriented? So that's why I think every person who is there on the panel today brings in the value, which is much needed to be shared with the audience, because what happened during COVID is not just an eye opener, but also a big reminder of what we have been doing to the quality of air. So before we formally, pass on the speaking rights to different panelists, there's some thoughts that I thought will be in the benefit of everyone to set the tone. First is, we always say that COVID has brought us into an uncharted territory, right? However, I believe that air pollution, the problem of air pollution, has been long known, and the lack of inaction has also been known for very long, especially in a country like India. To put into perspective, air pollution still kills more people across the globe than what COVID has killed so far. But the sense of urgency that it should be getting from the local action groups, the urban local bodies, the pollution control boards or governments, I think that still needs to be taken to the next level significantly. And what we have also been reading, and I'm sure all of us have been reading this who are interested in this topic, that air pollution is likely to make coronavirus even worse. And the bad news there is that while we were in the lockdowns, obviously we could see blue skies and we could see that the air quality had come into the range of 0 to 50, which is the ideal range recommended by the World Health Organization. But as the lockdowns are opening up, the lockdown is opening, the number of cases are rising, some cities, some countries are getting into the stages of community spread. So air pollution is likely to make it even worse, because the industrial activities to some extent are reviving, the traffic is reviving, all different sources of air pollution are reviving on the road. So that's not the ideal combination, but then we have to figure out what can be done to solve that. Also, I was reading recently, according to the recent research being done by Harvard University, an increase of just 1 microgram per cubic meter of PM2.5 corresponded to a 15% increase in COVID-19 deaths. Now, that's a fact that should shake everyone up if you're really wanting to contain the virus and save more people from dying across the globe. Experts also say that further investigation of the link between air pollution and COVID-19 is urgently needed if we really want to manage the pandemic better. The PM levels, the NOx levels, they're likely to be rising again as the restrictions are eased globally. Now see how the things have changed during the 2-3 months of lockdown that we experienced in India itself. Like I said, the air quality had already started being in the healthy range of 0 to 50, which was very, very pleasing, very surprising, something that we had not seen in decades. But from an environmental standpoint, it was also a point of worry that all of this gets back to normal, but we have been used to be living in the normal of the air quality of 200, 300 plus, which is the hazardous levels. Even today, Delhi's average air quality is more than 150 air quality index. So Mumbai and Bangalore are doing much better, but that is also because of the monsoon and consistent rains happening there, and Delhi has not received that. So we know that this is going to increase. So to put into perspective, I think there's some top issues which we will be able to address through each of you today. When I will voice out these issues, it'll be very natural for you to know that I'm talking about your talk here. First is, I think there is lack of data. Data always plays a very important role in taking decisions. We all know that. So I think having the right data, having data at the right locations, at the right time, and merging it with other trends is also very important. Enforcement of the policies and the notifications. We have all been acquainted with the National Clean Air Program and other actions that have been taken by the National Green Tribunal time and again. But have those been enforced on the ground? I will put in my thoughts later in the day as well, but we would love to hear from you as to what you have seen on the ground. Tackling one of the major sources of air pollution in various parts of the country, which is stubble burning. Just a month ago, we started seeing through the satellite images that the burning had again gone to the next level. And again, in spite of so many solutions coming in, the government had claimed that this will go down significantly, but the impact was not at the level as expected. Another important point is capturing the pollution at source. Whatever are these different sources of pollution, I think the key is, and the speakers can ponder upon that later, is capturing that pollution at source. And last but not the least, sensitization of public. When public got sensitized about COVID-19, the governments got sensitized about COVID-19, you could see the level of urgency, or I can say emergency, that was seen globally. But air pollution does not get their attention. Is it to do with public sensitization? Is it because people cannot always see the immediate impacts of air pollution on their health and their loved ones? I think let's discuss all of that. So without taking much time, I will request the first speaker of the day. And the reason I've set a certain order so that we talk about, so we go in a certain flow. So based on my interactions with all of you, we put down a certain order. So firstly, I'll request Dr. Ajay Nagpure, who's the head of air pollution at WRI India, to kindly take forward the discussion. Over to you, Dr. Nagpure.
Thank you, sir. Trying to share it up. I don't know, button is not working.
There's a button by the name share content, I guess.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
You want to make a presentation?
Yes.
Okay, just a second. Ashish, please pass on the right.
Yeah. So, can you see my screen?
Blank.
Now?
No.
It's coming. I don't know.
Coming as a black screen,
I mean,
can you?
Yes,
it's fine
now. Yeah, so good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Ashish. So, as you know that we are talking about the air pollution and what is the impact of the COVID-19 on the air pollution. So, I think you might have seen these pictures. I think these pictures were in the news, I think, 1 month before. So, this is an India Gate picture during the last winter, and this is the COVID-19 picture. So you can clearly see that how clean is the air, So, but the thing is that why we are talking too much about the air pollution, that's one of the important aspects. So why we all and too much concern about the air pollution. That in India, about 1.2 million people every year dying prematurely just because of the air pollution. And this is the third largest cause of risk factors after the dietary risk and high blood pressure. So these numbers are too much. 12 lakhs people are dying every year. But sometimes what is happening, like sometimes we don't believe on these numbers because these are the estimations. So whatever numbers you are getting in news about the health risks associated with the different risk factors from the different global agency, those are the estimated numbers. So sometimes we don't believe it because it's run by the agencies which is outside of our country. But this is another interesting figure. So the data were collected by the Indian Express I think 2 years back, and they collected the outpatient department of the two hospitals of respiratory wards. What they found, this is the Delhi data. What they found, in the respiratory OPD department, there is an increase in number of patients, about 300% jump in number of patients from 2005 to 2014-15. This 300% increase is huge, you know. So that's what, and most of these people who are coming to visit the outpatient department, especially because of the lungs problem, those are your family members, kids, and the elderly people. You know, so the air pollution is affecting the elderly people and kids because they have the weak lungs. That's the reason. So, Mung, I think the thing is that when, because here we are talking about the air pollution and what is the impact of the air pollution on the COVID-19 impact on the air pollution. So before that, we need to understand what causing the air pollution. So these figures is based on the research done for whole India about the sources. So you can see that for the particulate matter 2.5, industries, vehicle exhaust, biomass burning, road dust are the major sources of air pollution, especially when we are talking about the pan India as a study area, or the whole India as a study domain. And moving on to the next slide is about the cities. You can see that in cities, the paved and unpaved road dust, vehicle exhaust are the major sources of the air pollution. So why I'm talking about these sources, because we say that because of the COVID-19, there is a reduction in the air quality, air pollution. Why? Because during this strict lockdown period, all these activities were in halt. So we have not done anything. It's a natural thing because there was no activities of these sources. That's what we saw, a lot of decrease in air pollution. You know? So I have some figures I created. I think my team has collected a lot of data from the different monitoring station of our country, and they plotted the, I think we are working on that, how the COVID-19 has impacted the air quality. So this is the graph of the PM2.5 from March 1st to the about mid-April. So you can see that after the 25th March, there is a decrease in PM2.5 level, because after that we came up with the strict lockdown in the country. But I think when I was looking at this data, I found this peak on 10th March. Do you remember what was the day? 10th March was in Holi. That day was in Holi. So because of the Holi, there is a, you know, that our atmosphere is too sensitive. So because of the Holi, there was a peak in PM2.5 level in most of the cities of India. And after that, it's affected the air pollution, because, you know, before that, you can see that air quality level was, better. But during the Holi period, that suddenly we got a peak, and after that this remained almost, I think, the same. And after 25 after March, it started decreasing. The same trend has been observed for carbon monoxide. You can see that from the 25th March, there is a decrease in the PM carbon monoxide in different cities of India, and the same with the NOx variations, like the NOx, and NOx is the major. Transportation is a major contributing factor for the NOx. It's quite natural. So I think this is not us. I think when we are talking about this, is the air quality has improved. So there is nothing to celebrate. But I feel that it's a learning opportunity for us. What we can learn from these data sets, whatever the COVID has provided, so we can consider as an opportunity for our air pollution management, the future air pollution management, and how. And I'll talk about So first, I would like to share some maps. So this is the map which for the NOx we captured from the satellite imagery. So the imagery. So you can see that this map is the after the lockdown and what is the situation before. So you can see that this is the situation before. This is the situation before the lockdown or the NOx emission across the country, and after that it became like this. So, you know, so the country-wide there was a huge impact of the COVID-19 lockdown. Similarly, this sulfur dioxide pollution, this is the before lockdown period and this is after the lockdown periods. So you can see, so this is before and after. Same thing with carbon monoxide. This is before, this after. So there is, I think every pollutant we got a lot of improvement, and this is the map which is provided by the NASA. You can see this is in January 24th, 1st January to 24th March 2019, the NOx level across the country in India, 25th March to 28th April 2019, and here this is the during the lockdown period. So these types of maps which we are getting, but what is the use of these maps? What we can learn from these things, you know? So the thing is that we are having a different studies, different databases, other sources of the air pollution. For example, in Delhi, there was I think during a strict lockdown, there was no activities of the industries, transportation, but still the air pollution level, the air quality level are far above the threshold limit provided by the World Health Organizations and Center Pollution Control Board. What we can learn from this, I think we might be missing some sources, or there is something which local sources or regional sources are causing those level up, because if there was no activity that in that period, but still the air quality level was high in terms of the standard and the guideline. That is the most important thing which we can learn from this data set. Also, in many parts of the country, many studies say that the biomass burning is one of the largest cause of air pollution in a different part. But those regions were showing the decrease in air pollution. It means that biomass burning could be one of the largest sources, but we might be missing some other sources. So by using the COVID-19 lockdown data, by analyzing each sources and activity data and correlating with the air pollution data, we could definitely learn something which would be useful for the future air quality management. So this is the outdoor air pollution. So in terms of the outdoor air pollution, we saw some kind of benefit of the COVID-19 lockdown. But the thing is that there is a negative impact of the COVID-19 lockdown on the indoor air pollution. So according to the recent National Sample Survey Organization, I think in 2018 they did the survey, 87% of the urban population and 48% of the rural population uses LPG as the primary fuel. You know? And remaining still depends on the biomass as a primary fuel for cooking. And we also did an analysis, and what we found that many of these primary fuel users are using polluting fuel as a secondary fuel. So means like they are using LPG for some cooking purpose and for biomass for water heating and other purposes. So the thing is that, so what we did first, we analyzed the data sets about the fuel users across the country. This is the paper which I am submitted to one research journal. So you can see the green is the urban part and this red is the rural part, and this is the secondary polluting fuel users. Generally, we feel that we have a lot of LPG consumer in urban areas, but many of these LPG users are still using biomass as a secondary fuel. So this figure is showing that percentage of the LPG users are using biomass as a secondary fuel. Why I'm talking about this? Because this is the one of the leading cause of for the indoor air pollution. Similarly, as to how this COVID-19 has impacted negatively the indoor air pollution and how it increases the PM2.5 level from the household cooking fuel. So I did a detailed study for this sector. So what I did first, I just estimated the primary and secondary fuel uses by different states and urban or rural area. And then in second data analysis, what I did, I estimated the number of people eating outside during normal days. So this blue line is the urban people, the percentage of the urban people eating their meal outside. You know, number of meal they are eating outside in a day, different urban people, and these are the rural people across the country. So what happened during lockdown period? All these meals shifted to indoor. So what is the impact of this meal shift? There is an increase in the PM2.5 level in from the household which are using biomass as a secondary fuel or the primary. So the COVID-19 lockdown has increased the air pollution from the household sector, 166 ton. That is the analysis based on the primary data as available, micro data available across the country. So which I did recently. Similarly, during the lockdown period, many people has to, I think, forced to stay inside. And this is the map which is I think one of the done by the one of the author from the South India. So they estimated the indoor air pollution concentration. So you know that's 800. In Uttar Pradesh by these seasons, so the household indoor air concentration is far more than the outdoor concentration. So means like the people who are staying inside their household, they are more exposed to the outdoor air pollution. So what I did to analyze how the COVID-19 lockdown has increased this exposure. So what I did, I first went to the time use survey for the different age group during normal days. What I found, so there are people, I think people generally spend their 20% of their time outside of the house. Means if they are a biomass users, they are, I think 20% time they are exposed to less pollution as compared to their indoor household pollution. What happened? So this is the age-wise exposure level I estimated for the different states. So the AP is the Andhra Pradesh, AR is Arunachal Pradesh. So similarly for the all states. So the blue line is the normal day exposure of the indoor air pollution. And this orange line is the COVID-19 lockdown exposure period. So you can see that because of the COVID-19 lockdown, people are more exposed to the air pollution. So there are positive and negative impacts of the air pollution, COVID-19 on the air pollution, and we need to consider both positive and negative impacts of the COVID-19 lockdown period on both indoor and household pollution. And this data could be useful for a future policy formulation and understand which are the sources contributing more to the atmosphere. So with this, I would stop. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ajay. That was a quick presentation full of a lot of data. And I think, if you're comfortable sharing it with the audience, you can share it later so everyone can benefit from it. Because such data points, I think, are the starting point of identifying what are the problems. And then we move slowly towards policies, action on the ground. Like today, for example, Prarthana will be talking about how action has been taken in 1,000 cities across Asia. And then we have solution makers on our side, and similarly. So I think with this, I will invite Divya. Divya, can you hear me? Divya, you're on mute. If you could unmute yourself. Can you hear me now, Divya?
I can't unmute myself.
Okay, we can hear you now.
Okay, great.
So everyone, Divya is the program management officer at UN Environment Program, and I think hearing from her about the recent work that has been done specifically in India would be a benefit to everyone. So over to you, Divya.
Thank you very much, Ashish, and thank you also for inviting me to be part of this panel. It's very nice to see a lot of familiar faces. Prarthana, great to see you. And it was also very, very informative to hear Dr. Nagpure. I think we got a very good sense of the baseline of what is possible, you know, if we are able to sort of take some preventive measures and arrest some sources of air pollution in the country. Of course, having said that, and this is something that the government has been saying and all UN agencies have also been saying, is that the improvement in air quality should not be seen as a silver lining of the pandemic. Instead, we should see it as, you know, having got a flavor of what clean environment is like, and then this should really push us towards taking greater action. So I think that's the purpose it has served, and I think it has served it rather well. So with that, I'll make a brief presentation to just give you a sense of what we are doing in India in the area of air pollution. I'm going to share my screen. I hope that's going to be possible.
I think the rights should be with you now.
No, it's not letting me share. Ah, okay, now proper hands now. Okay, great. Sorry about this.
I think, Divya, if sharing the presentation is an issue, you can start off in the meantime. So,
are you able to hear me?
Actually, we can also see your screen now, so we can also hear
you. Okay, great. Okay, all right. So, let me see if this works. Yeah. Okay, great. Now, as we've already heard, and I'm not going to dwell on these numbers for very long because, you know, we've heard them all too often, and in fact, we've heard them so often that they don't really have the impact that they're meant to have on us. We know that air pollution is the largest health risk of our times. And the numbers are staggering. We've all been hearing about it. And it's not, you know, it's what is particularly bothering is when you hear numbers about the impact that air pollution is having on young children, both in terms of mortality, but also in terms of long-term morbidity and long-term cognitive and the impacts on motor skills and motor development. So I think these are data that should have woken us into action long time back, unfortunately. As somebody said at a conference recently, there is enough knowledge, but still very little acknowledgement of the problem that we have at hand. So we know that it's not only about health, it's also about various ecological services and the productivity of ecological systems that are getting negatively impacted by poor air quality. And air pollution is also fundamentally altering our climate with profound impacts on the health of the planet and all its inhabitants. Air pollution is also very fundamentally, because of what we spoke earlier, linked to several of the Sustainable Development Goals. And these include social goals like poverty, hunger, health, gender, and also the more sort of obvious ones like clean energy, industry, sustainable consumption, production, and climate action. So when we address this problem, we are in effect addressing a number of other problems that we are grappling with, and also sort of pushing ourselves towards the Sustainable Development Goal targets that we have, and that we are sort of very... we're sort of falling back on for a number of them. If you look at what the United Nations is doing, in United Nations Environment Programme in particular, we have United Nations Environment Assembly, which meets every 2 years. And ever since the first assembly in 2014, air pollution has received a lot of emphasis. And these are some of the resolutions that have been passed by member states around air pollution in collaboration on issues related to air pollution. And these relate to addressing air pollution and its sources, both photogenic as well as natural, such as sand and dust storms, which has been a very controversial issue. Understanding the linkage between environment and health better, and also a number of issues that I've listed here, which these resolutions provide UNEP the mandate to do and to work with member states on. So it's capacity building, public outreach and awareness, international cooperation, of course, monitoring, collection and assessment of air quality data, both at the national level, but also subnational, but also regional and global, as well as analyzing, identifying technology and policy best practices. And in the agenda for the program, as you know, you had a list of all these and you said what's going to work, but it's really all of this. And I'm sorry if this sounds rather sweeping, but that's what it is. And you know, we have the information and the knowledge on what it'll take, and it's a lot of these, and it's really now all about implementation and getting our act together. So what we also know now very well is that air pollution is the result of multiple sources, and these sources, the importance of these sources, we know vary according to cities, according to the state of the climatic conditions, the geographical conditions, the topography, and a whole range of factors, and also vary by seasons, as we've seen in the case of Delhi. But broadly, if you look at this Sankey diagram for the major pollutants, you will see that it's the use of energy in different sources, whether it's power sector, industry, transport, buildings, or fuel supply itself, that is the cause of the large majority of most of the pollutants that are a cause of worry, particularly particulate matter. But really, it sort of shows that you need action across sectors and not just one sector. So often, you know, you see that, you hear that for Delhi, for instance, it'll be, it's urban transport that is the cause of all problem. But we've seen with the odd even intervention that the first time around it worked a little bit, the second time around it didn't. And, you know, you can say it was because people found ways around it, but also because that's not the only source of air pollution. Construction is a big issue. Natural dust is a big issue. So you really need to address all of these together if you are to make a sizable difference to the problem that we have at hand. So sort of considering these facts, UNEP is engaging across sectors on the issue of air pollution. And if you look at what we're doing in India, then the resolutions, the UNEA resolutions that I spoke about, are basically, they sort of are consonant with many of the sectoral interventions that are recommended by NCAP. And, you know, the ones that are red ticked here are the list which is common between what UNEA resolutions has been saying and what NCAP is recommending. So whether it's sectoral interventions, for instance, on e-mobility, on the transport sector, or on agricultural waste burning, whether it is issues of capacity building, data monitoring, or whether it is just awareness raising. So all these issues have been highlighted time and again, and are now very much a part of the National Clean Air Program of the Government of India, which is aiming to bring down the level of air pollution by 20-30% between 2024 as compared to 2017. We don't yet have an official assessment of how we are doing. We are already about a year plus into this NCAP target, and it'll be good to see if there is already an assessment. The anecdotal sort of evidence that we have, you know, based on what we are observing in cities, is that we are still far from meeting this target, but it'll be good for us to, you know, for the government particularly, to sort of come out with something which shows us how these how the trends are doing with respect to where we want to reach with respect to the NCAP target. So with that overview, I'll very quickly, you know, tell you a little bit about what we are doing specifically in India, and we can then discuss this later during the Q&A. We are working in Agra, and the Prarthna is here. We've done this with Clean Air Asia, the development of the Agra City Air Action Plan, where we've supported the Uttar Pradesh Pollution Control Board in developing the plan. We're also now looking at working with a group of stakeholders to actually support the implementation of this plan. And what we're also doing is developing training modules on urban air quality management, including how data can be collected and analyzed, what kind of data can be collected, how it should be collected, and the analysis of this data, and also preparing toolkits that can be used for training people in the pollution control boards, but also trainers who can use this information and become local air quality managers. We're also doing specific work with the industrial cluster in Agra, where we're doing an assessment, a source inventory, an emissions inventory of the key industrial sources in Agra. And what we're finding is that coal use remains considerable in industry, even in Agra, despite, you know, the whole sort of work around the Taj Trapezium. So that is an area we're investigating further, and we will have the results from this emissions analysis very soon, in about a month's time, and we're very happy to share them with you. And we'll be using that result and that analysis to then take up a few priority sectors for pilot demonstration of policy recommendations with the Uttar Pradesh Pollution Control Board and the government of Uttar Pradesh. So apart from that work in Agra, we're also doing sectoral interventions in different parts of the country. E-mobility is an important area of work. We're working with Maharashtra, with Uttar Pradesh on developing their e-mobility plans. This is being done with EESL. Brick kilns, agricultural burning, municipal solid waste. In all these areas, we're working both on training as well as identifying technology best practices. In the case of agricultural burning, we're also looking at doing some pilot demonstration of what technologies might work for biogas. So this is a range of different things that we're doing on these sectors. I want to particularly highlight the work we're doing on environment and health. This is something that we are working with the Ministry of Environment and Forests and the Ministry of Health on. And what we've done is set up this. But what you're proposing is a joint working group with these two ministries in the lead for us to identify the gaps in understanding of the linkages between environment and health. Because often, even now, there is lack of acceptance, you know, at the highest level. And we've seen that when it comes to the health impacts of poor environmental parameters. So we're working with these two ministries to look at this interface, not just in the case of air pollution, but for a range of other pollutants. And what we've also initiated under this, and it was very informative when we did this, was a training program for health officials in Uttar Pradesh on this interface and all these interlinkages. And, because when for a lot of the health officials, when people go to them with respiratory symptoms, it will be the standard sort of medicines that will be prescribed. But very little investigation will happen in terms of what is the cooking fuel you are using, or which is the area you are living in, what is the level of air pollution in that area. So we're also sensitizing the health officials to look at the impact that air pollution may be having in either causing or exacerbating respiratory conditions that people may have. So I think this is a very important aspect. And the main sort of takeaway we had from this pilot workshop was that, the health departments are so stretched as it is, that for them to be able to analyze these aspects will require much more data and data collection systems in their facilities. So I think that's something that we need to think about, and that it's something we're already thinking about as the UN. On how we can have data protocols, and actually NCDC in the Ministry of Health is already thinking about this, what kind of data protocols are required by to be put in place by healthcare facilities so that these elements are adequately captured and then integrated in the kind of treatment that people are offered. What we're also proposing is an air quality action forum, because there is so much work and, you know, there's so many partners in this event itself that we think it's very important for all of us to come together and not just do our own, you know, our own activities, but to see how all this is adding up and what may not be sort of being looked at the moment. What are the gaps that are remaining after we've taken account of what each one of us is doing? So this is something which we're pushing, and the ministry is also very keen on this. In fact, Ministry of Environment and Forest is actually very keen that something like this is done, because there are so many agencies now in India which are working on air pollution, that it'll be good to sort of have a coordinated platform where everyone brings their offerings as well as their findings for more robust policy input. And then there is the Breathe Life campaign. This is an awareness and communication campaign. It's a joint initiative of the WHO, UNEP, and the Climate and Clean Air Coalition. And the idea here is to work not just at the national level, but to work at the city level and to motivate cities and subnational governments to take up their own targets and sort of become more ambitious about controlling air pollution, even as the sort of national machinery may take time. And we're very happy that Bangalore is already part of this initiative. And a very small village in Andhra Pradesh, Chilamathur Mandal, has also joined the Breathe Life campaign. And more recently, Nagpur, Dehradun, Bhubaneswar have committed to meeting the air quality standards as per NCAP. And we're hoping that they will become full members of the Breathe Life campaign and take on even more ambitious targets in the months to come. So with that, I'm going to end with some parting thoughts. I think it's important for us to keep in mind that only a few, less than 8% of the population of Asia and Pacific, actually enjoys healthy air. The rest of us, however, have now got a feel of what healthy air might be like during the lockdown. And really, this is an opportunity for us to use this feel, this taste of the good thing that we got for a few days, for greater ambition, to push for a greater ambition for cleaner air, push our governments and push ourselves in terms of agency work and individual work on what we can do for cleaner air. Because what our analysis finds is that if current policies which are aimed at limiting emissions are effectively introduced and enforced, air pollution or air quality will be no worse in 2030 than it was in 2015. You know, but it'll not improve. It'll be no worse despite population growth, rapid urbanization, and sort of, you know, growth of industry, etc. We may be able to keep it where it was in 2015, but we'll not see a significant improvement, which means that there will be billions of people still who will be exposed to health damaging levels of air pollution even in 2030. And which also means that if you are to see an improvement, then you really need to be doing much more than what you are doing. So while moving to Bharat Stage 6 is a good idea, that's not going to solve our problem. We really need to be much more ambitious if we really want to see an improvement in air quality. So NCAP in that sense is a step in the right direction, and we really need to ensure that it is implemented effectively. There are also some other very good developments that have happened recently. One that I like to highlight is the fact that the 15th Finance Commission has actually introduced air quality as a parameter in disbursements of money from the center to the state, in fact, to the local bodies. So I think they've kept about 4,000 crores for urban local bodies of the a million plus cities. One of the benchmarks, and I think the only benchmark they've prescribed here for them to receive this money will be some indicators of air quality. And these indicators are being developed by the Ministry of Environment and Forest. This goes to show that at that highest level of fiscal federalism, the issue of air pollution is getting attention and is being linked to a very important revenue handle of the subnational governments. And this, we hope, will be a very important instrument for city governments to take action. And, you know, this is as far as public finance is concerned, but we think that with a favorable and enabling environment, the private sector and businesses can also play a very important role in investing in cleaner technologies. And this is not just in sectoral technologies such as in e-mobility or renewable energy, but we're also talking about low-cost monitoring stations, for instance, monitors, air quality monitors, where the private sector can play an important role. So I think these are all things that we need to, some of these are new ideas which need a little more brainstorming, because you know the quality protocols, etc., will be an issue. But if we really want that data, then we will need to engage more stakeholders and see how we can create the platforms for all of us to work collectively on this issue. So I'll stop with that, and I'll be happy to come back to any of these issues during the Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Divya, for the detailed presentation. And I'm glad you mentioned that the National Clean Air Program is definitely a step in the right direction. However, you know, a lot of times when you were mentioning the sources of pollution, the recognized sources of pollution like commercial vehicles or industrial activities, or even to some extent poor waste management contributing to air pollution, I think, you know, that's an observation over the last couple of years, because we have been doing a lot of advocacy on NCAP as well, wherein we have seen that one of the major sources of air pollution is also the diesel generators in India, which contribute anywhere between 7 to 18% of ambient air pollution in the non-attainment cities. And obviously, the number of non-attainment cities are on the rise. We have seen that NCAP rolled out certain guidelines. There were NGT orders. The lack of enforcement, and I think the lack of compliance, that definitely needs to go to the next level. And for that, communities, activity, you know, the activism has to all go up, apart from, you know, waking up the local pollution control board. So definitely there is a huge scope. And yes, completely agree to the point of having more data on our side, because only then we can understand what are the possible sources, what are the trends, and then accordingly come up with these different plans, some of which you have very rightly mentioned, and giving example of Agra as well. So thank you so much. I think we have some questions coming in, but in interest of the time, because we are running a little behind the schedule and we have three more speakers to go, so we'll park these questions for towards the end. And you know, without taking much time, I'll request Prathna Bora, who's the India Director for Clean Air Asia, to kindly share her thoughts with us. I know there has been some intersection with what also Divya talked about regarding the initiatives in Agra and Agra. But we definitely look forward to hear from you, Prathna. Over to you.
Thank you, Ashish. And thanks, Ajay and Divya, for your presentations. So I'm not really going to talk about what Clean Air Asia has been doing over the last couple of years, because you know, ultimately it is our you know, it's our mandate to work on air, so we have been doing you know, a lot of stuff. But what I'm going to really talk about is how the you know, how the whole issue of air quality is being discussed you know, in a pre-COVID, pre-COVID, during COVID, and during lockdown, post-lockdown kind of an timing, and also in terms of how we're looking at where this whole issue is going to go, because I think that's an important discussion to have. And unfortunately, I am not very optimistic that the focus on air pollution is going to be, you know, like, I mean, obviously, post-lockdown, I think the focus on air pollution is not, I mean, going to have the same kind of energy as it did, you know, just before the lockdown. So I think Ajay touched upon it in terms of, you know, in terms of the whole issue of, I think there's a lot of background noise. Can you please announce that, you know, otherwise it's very difficult to concentrate. Because I think there's some mics on, and it's very distracting. So anyways, so I just wanted to touch upon what Ajay touched, you know, very briefly, in terms of, you know, how the air quality index, as well as, you know, air pollution levels have kind of shown remarkable change in a positive manner as far as the lockdown is concerned. And we've just completed a study on Delhi's air quality, which we're doing for the DPCC in terms of looking at pre-lockdown, during lockdown, and you know, lockdown, opening of the lockdown, for lockdown 2.0, lockdown 1.0, and lockdown 2.0. So I think, I mean, I'm not going to talk too much, but I just want to put in a few points in terms of like, okay, on 19th March, before the lockdown, the AQI index was 250. And then about a month and a week later, 27th, 28th March, it was below 50, which means that, you know, there was a tremendous, tremendous, dip. But if you look at lockdown 2.0 and exactly 1 month later, that is 27th of April, it shot up to 120. So I think, that actually opens up a lot of opportunity for research in terms of how do we look at our studies. Are they, if a slight opening up of the economy can make a more than a 50% increase in the air pollution levels, then I think there's a time to look back and look at some of these studies that have been done in terms of do they need revisiting in terms of how we look at our air quality, the source opportunity studies, etc. Now, coming to the mix of pollutants, I think if you look at, I'm just talking about Delhi at the moment. I mean, we have data for other cities, but right now I just want to focus on Delhi because Delhi has been always discussed so much. So if you look at PM10, it decreased, 60% decrease was there. PM2.5, 39% decrease. NOx, 71% decrease. And then, you have, of course, CO, carbon monoxide, which was about 30%. SOx and methane, not too much. But there was an increase in ozone. So I think, again, there's an opportunity there in terms of looking at what are the key pollutants that are showing changes as far as complete shutdown situation is concerned, and transitioning to opening up the economy is concerned. So I think what this actually brings us to, I think what the dialogue that we need to be discussing, and if Delhi could reach a below 50 AQI on the 27th of March, then there was a discussion before that we could never go beyond a particular number like 100. So if we could go below 50, do we need to rethink what we can achieve in the coming as we move on in a transition, and what are the things that we need to do? So that's an area that we are working on and we are trying to develop with the DPCC. And it also goes with our work around, addressing micro-level project interventions around the hotspots. So that's one area. The second area that, with the transitioning and everybody's talking about issues like green economy and green transition and moving on cleaner energy sources and things like that. But if you look at the policy directions at the moment, are not so much, in that direction. So, if you look at the industrial clusters, for instance, how we do not discuss the industrial clusters separately because, most of the air work or the policy directives are around city plans. So obviously, many of these industrial clusters do not fall under the purview. So there is a separate kind of, it's not really integrated in the city plan. So if you look at, say, for instance, if you look at an industrial cluster like Vapi, the AQI index dropped from 313 to 100, which was like a huge drop. And areas like Kanpur had a 50% improvement in air quality. Vizag had a 42% improvement, and Ahmedabad had 98% improvement. So if you look at that, I think it's important for us to realize that industrial areas need to be looked at, as an entity, and how do we actually look at maintaining these, these good. Obviously, you wouldn't be able to maintain the kind of air quality levels that were evident during the lockdown. But how do we, look at a transition in terms of the industrial sector and the industrial belt in terms of addressing air pollution? Do we need to look at a separate mechanism? The NCAP talks about the industry, but it doesn't integrate the clean air action plans with the industry sector. So that's an area probably where, we are intervening and seeing how we could mainstream air quality into the whole city, addressing the city city action, as well as, you know, looking at how industrial clusters can evolve as, you know, clean air zones. The third area that I think we don't talk about enough is the whole issue of behavioral change, because I think one of the things that has been a self-realization for us, as well as something that we really need to look inwards to think about, is the fact that we have fear has actually changed our lifestyles, and we will be obviously continuing with that fear for some time, and which is going to give us a very, very, you know, it's going to make our lifestyle choices very different from what we preach about. So for instance, I mean, I think our transportation choices are something to be very concerned about, in the sense that post COVID, post lockdown, we would still be very wary about things like public transportation, and, you know, moving, and, you know, kind of anything that is not sheltered and we don't feel safe in. So how does one deal with an issue like that? Because it is very, 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 it's easy to say that policy directives need to move towards, you know, public transportation. But I think under such conditions and in such a situation, how do we actually move towards transportation choices? Is it going to lead to a boom in terms of, you know, driving private cars? And I have friends who have never had private cars, because, you know, we are from old school and we try to practice sustainability, but everybody is now contemplating the whole issue of, you know, of a private car. So I think there are several other behavioral issues that might come to terms with. I mean, I think we talk about work from home as a choice, which we would probably see a lot, which has a positive aspect that there is reduced transportation, but we also need to look at the kind of energy use, the electronic use that we would be, you know, actually encouraging by this kind of thing. And Divya spoke about the integrated approach. So I think that these are issues that, as an air quality community, we need to be also start talking about, because I think the new normal is going to bring up all these questions and is going to be very challenging from the perspective of air quality, because, you know, from a policy perspective, there is going to be a huge interest on recovery and job creation and, you know, kind of GDP increase. So I think these are some of the questions that I think it's important to discuss, and I'll stop there now. So.
Thank you, Prarthana. I think you've put in some very realistic points. You know, we tend to talk about problems, policies not being implemented, but what you've brought into the picture is this realistic picture of what is going to be the priority, because reviving economic activities, jobs, and, you know, people changing their personal preferences, moving from public to private transport. So while all of that happens, because that is also important, how do we tackle, the pollution levels in different cities? And again, different cities are different sources and different problems. So I think, yes, working closely, you know, with these policies and the programs that are already in place. And now, because see, it's all about being agile. 3 months ago or 4 months ago, we didn't know that we'll be in the situation. Maybe we would have been making far better strides on air pollution than what was expected. But this situation happened, and we knew that when everything opens up, it's all going to be either back to the same stage or even worse, because now the lifestyle, the activities is going to come back in full force, and it will not just be business as usual. So thanks for pointing it out. And, we do have a few questions that have come in. And I think we can take one question now, and we'll take more towards the end. A question that has come in is there a need for a drone-based real-time air quality measurement? A lot of geospatial coverage is possible. So here, I think the gentleman is trying to ask about, because we have limited air monitoring stations. So would a drone-based real-time air quality measurement, have you heard about it? Do you think something like that could be helpful for monitoring purposes?
Are you asking me the question? I think Ajay is a better person to answer that question.
It's open for everyone. Ajay, would you like to take it up?
Yeah, so I think in India, I don't see any need of drone-based monitoring system right now. I think I feel better. We need a stationary monitoring station in the cities where we don't have any monitoring station, or it's because you know that we. I think especially the most of the pollution control boards, they have a lot of budget constraints. So putting the small low cost sensor would be the better option. So drone based monitoring station or monitoring system would require when we have that kind of a system, air quality management systems, you know. So I don't see any, we don't need any kind of system right now. In future, we may need.
I think I completely agree. I think we first have to solve the basics of having enough monitoring stations where we don't even have that as of today.
Yeah.
Prathamik, what do you?
Yeah, I was just wanting to add that I think the question is not just about, you know, whether we need more monitoring. I think it's also about what we're using it for. So it depends. I mean, you know, it's very easy to say, okay, we shouldn't use low-cost sensors, we shouldn't use satellite-based data. But I think every data that is generated has specific use which it can be applied to. So even if we do have a drone-based monitoring system, I mean, I think what we need to discuss is why do we need the drone and for what do we want to use it for? So I think, even if we do use it, I think it's more important to look at what we are going to use it for. So I think that's
probably. Yeah, I think the Prathna has, I think I agree with Prathna because not for the air quality measurement, but for example, the waste burning. We don't have any monitoring system for the waste burning. So we could use drone-based monitoring system to identify where is the waste burning is happening. So
right. Yeah, I think also depending on the demographics and the limitations of geographies across the country, there could be a possible option. The purpose is, I think, the objective should be in the line of identifying different sources of pollution and having sufficient monitoring data points, because I think we lack that significantly in a lot of major cities as well, even of today, which does not help us derive the right numbers. Like, for example, you know, air quality actually at a given position, at a given GPS point could be, let's say, 250. But the air quality monitoring station, which is 2 kilometers from here, could be showing just, you know, 100, 150. So the point is, how do we tackle that problem? Because in fact, it's also aligning to a question that has come in wherein they were talking about that we're talking about air quality issues or air quality index at the level which is generalized from an urban perspective or, you know, certain cities perspective. The more local we are able to get into the approach of monitoring and then devising policies, because there are certain pockets within the cities as well as rural areas which are more polluted than others, and they need localized action, localized awareness, localized policy making. So I think, yeah, in those directions, we need to ensure more and more monitoring happening. Without taking much time, you know, we'll move on to our next speaker for today. And now we'll be getting more into the innovation and solution mode, because the next two presentations will also be talking about how they did an innovation or how they're utilizing technology to tackle the air pollution at a certain stage. So I'll now request Riya Mazumdar Singhal, who is the founder and CEO of EcoWare, which is the largest and the first sustainable packaging company in India. And we all must have heard about it already, but today we'll hear it directly from Riya. Over to you.
Thank you, Ashish. Thank you. It's very inspiring listening to Prathna, Divya and Ajay. As a citizen who lives in Delhi with two small kids, this is something that's very close to my heart. So thank you for letting me be part of this. So I moved to India about 11 years ago now, and that's when I founded my company, EcoWare. You know, I think we're all very clear that pollution is our planet's greatest environmental threat. The two types of pollution that are very close to my heart are plastic pollution, and when I say plastic pollution, I mean specifically single-use plastic, and obviously air pollution. And you know, when I founded EcoWare in 2009, it was to tackle these very two issues. So we wanted to get rid of, I was quite disturbed by the amount of single-use plastic people were using, right? They were eating very freely out of it without understanding the negative health benefits. And we live in a country where we have no formal waste segregation or waste treatment. So where did it end up? In our ever-growing landfills. And I wanted to change that. So I wanted to create something that was safe for humanity to eat out of, and the environment. So what we do is we use different types of plant biomass, or what's also known as agri-waste, that's typically burnt, as you know, or used as animal fodder, as our raw material, and we convert that into, through a thermoforming process, we convert that into packaging for the food and beverage industry, right? So, and 100%, and all our products are 100% compostable, biodegradable, and the beauty is that it's backyard biodegradable. So if you were to dig a hole in your backyard, dump one of our products in soil, it will break down and turn into soil in 90 days, which basically means that you don't have to rely again on any formal waste segregation system. Our entire portfolio includes a whole range of plates, cups, bowls, takeaway boxes, and we're constantly adding, obviously, to these shapes and sizes depending on the need. And they can be used across cuisines. They sustain a temperature range from -20 to 180 degrees. So what that means for anyone who's using EcoWare is that you could bake in it, refrigerate it, freeze it, or microwave your food in it very safely. And typically our clients across the globe include the travel sector. So you would find our products at food courts and the airports. The Indian Railways is something that a client that's very close to our heart, because we worked over about a 10 to 12 month period to get rid of the aluminum casseroles that they serve their, that they used to serve their food in, and replace them with biodegradable meal trays. So food is packed in our trays up to 10 hours prior and then heated just before being served to passengers. The quick service restaurant segment, so we're looking at Subway, Cinnabon, Haldiram's, large scale canteens, whether you're looking at colleges or corporate offices, the likes of JP Morgan, Goldman Sachs, Bain. We work a lot with events that are now driven to become zero waste, and we retail as well to, you know, which is our B2C channel. And obviously, we're really proud of the impact that we've created in our 11-year journey. So, which has been threefold from an environmental perspective. Just last year, we displaced over 50 million pieces of single-use plastic. And also 100% of our revenue is derived from a circular economy model. From a social perspective, we create an industry that didn't exist before. So we've obviously created employment, and I take a lot of pride in the fact that 30% of our 120 people team are women. And I think from a health perspective, it's very straightforward. Our products don't change the nutritional value of the food that you put in it. And if you reduce your exposure to plastic, you reduce your risk of disease. And you know, moving forward for us, we see a massive scale-up opportunity, specifically in the food and beverage industry, because we feel that EcoWare is even more pertinent in the post-COVID world. A lot of the restaurants are currently moving away to takeaway delivery models or cloud kitchen models, and guidelines for these are all the guidelines use the use of disposable items only, and we obviously don't want to see this industry regress to using single-use plastic, especially when better alternatives such as EcoWare are available. And secondly, we obviously want to create more jobs, improve livelihood, and thirdly for us it's like new applications in India. So we started off with food and beverage, and we want to see what more is it that we can do. Can we support the e-commerce industry? Can we support the medical industry? I mean, India is a biomass rich nation. We're constantly doing R&D to explore the different types of feedstock that we can use. And, you know, just replace as much single-use plastic and stop burning. So that's kind of what we want to do at EcoWare, and kind of very simply kill two birds with one stone. You know, like I think everyone who spoke prior to me has talked about how we've seen clear blue skies and experienced clean air in the last couple of months. And, you know, I've lived in the city for 10 years and I don't remember the last time this happened. And obviously we're seeing that change as we're unlocking. And I think that we have to make sure that health and economy go hand in hand. Businesses need to adapt to the new normal and re-engineer the way they function. We need to test explore multiple solutions and scale solutions which have already shown success on the ground. And I think most importantly, we owe it to ourselves and the future generations to kind of to build back better, basically. So that's EcoWare in a nutshell, really.
Great. So, Riya, while, you know, I personally know about your product for quite some time now, but I think a lot of people out here really understand this, an interesting offering that you have, wherein you are, like you said, killing two birds with the same stone. And most importantly, again, single-use plastic eventually contributes to air pollution as well, because we know that a lot of this gets incinerated or burnt. At the same time, a lot of, you know, in a generic way, a lot of single-use plastic is making a comeback during the pandemic, just because of the notion that it seems to be more hygienic and safe, which is definitely not the case. I think, and as there have been studies that the virus can sustain on plastic for 4 to 5 days. So I think it's just a matter of, from a citizen level, it's all about cutting the misinformation. And you're already seeing great response from the public as well as the private sector. I think as far as I remember when we met last year, we spoke about that the solutions are environment friendly and cost effective. You know, they are the future. And I know you guys are working in that direction already. And hence, you know, a lot of places where we go, we spot EcoWare products, and we are very proud of it. You know, to see that, you know, these such solutions are being accepted in the industry, and more people are recognizing the importance of these things. So thank you so much for sharing, you know, all these details. And we'll have a few more questions, and we'll come back to you with those later in the presentation today.
Sure. Thank you.
So I think just I think maybe we'll be hitting a perfect timing, because we have 20 minutes to go, because we have filed 90 minutes for this. So we have one more presentation, and then we'll take a few questions, because we have a lot of questions coming in from the audience and an interest of their time and attention to this. We will try and take up as many as possible. So the final presentation of today, I'll request Madhusudan, who is the co-founder and CTO at Ambi. And they're working on, you know, we've been talking about data, AI, and I think let's hear it from him as to what they've been doing on that front. Over to you, Madhusudan.
Hey, sure. Thanks. Thanks, everyone. It was great hearing everyone talk about a lot of things on air pollution. What sort of strikes out is, I mean, I don't have anything to share in terms of presentation, but I have a lot of context to give you all. Something where we come in as Ambi. So it was great hearing Dr. Nagpure, and also from Divya Dutt on the UN, especially because Ambi was recognized at a UN summit for SDG, because we built a solution using data that encompassed multiple SDGs, solar impulse. We also come in on the action side, because like what Divya and also what Prarthana ma'am rightly said, that, you know, knowledge, we have so much information about these sensors not being there. We have a lot of data, a lot of articles coming out, but knowledge alone can't be power, and power can, you know, action cannot only be power. So action without knowledge, or knowledge without action. So we come right at that spot. And one thing common, what everybody spoke today, was about data. So that's where we come in as Ambi. We're an environmental data intelligence platform. We combine knowledge and action, and then help a lot of companies build population. So let me give you a lot of solutions. Let me give you a quick number, okay? And then I want to talk about for this for all the audience. So right now, the air quality in Delhi is 120, okay? Bangalore is at about averaging at around 60 to 70. And Mumbai is around something similar. Now, besides when air is bad, you can wear a mask, but is there something you can do about? No, right? You can't. But what if I told you you can? So a few years ago, when I moved to Bangalore from Hyderabad, I had my 6-month-old son waking up in the middle of the night, coughing and choking and struggling to breathe. And, you know, the doctors had told us that, you know, he could be turning asthmatic, and they had no idea. Now, like being a father, I could not just sit by and do nothing about it. So I put together a rudimentary air monitoring sensor. And I was able to see that when I Googled out, the air quality was closer, about 13 kilometers away from where I lived, the monitoring station. And I just want to tell you how it all impacts. And that station said 25. PM2.5 was 25, AQI was 40, indicating everything is great and clean and healthy. But the air monitoring that monitor that I built showed air quality of 800. Now that was the beginning of the problem. Now this is where Ambi began for us, and we've come a long way. So much that, you know, when we showed it to the doctors, they acknowledged the problem. When I moved my house based on air quality, without any medication, my son is 5 years old now and completely fine, and never asthma, none of that never happened, which would have otherwise. But when I looked at the community that still lives there are still thousands of people suffering from it. So that's where we took on this challenge to helping not just doctors now on our platform along with the parents, but also a lot of people are now making many micro decisions, and we're helping them with a lot of actions that help people actually breathe better. So we are trying to empower with, if you visit one of our websites, solution that we show, we also introduced the world's first, India's first pollen data, which is very hyperlocal, on indianairpollution.com. That's www.indianairpollution.com. And when you look at it, you can type location where you live, and you know what kind of air you're breathing, how it's impacting your loved ones. You can subscribe to it. And we're trying to solve this problem of data. Just coming back to the data part, which has been the common topic across all the speakers today, we are trying to solve exactly that by bringing this data accessible to every individual who's living. And I think changing behavior of someone, which also Prasanna spoke about, is very right, but it is very hard to do unless we tell them the impact of their micro decisions and how overall social innovation can happen. We also come in, you know, in part of what is happening during COVID, that people saw clean air, but they also will see a comeback of the economy being made, and that many industries, many people will, you know, produce more air pollution, which we've seen in unlock places where there's unlock in place, where, you know, pollution is coming back to the same thing. So, you know, that's where we come in terms of carbon capture and storage, to be it empowering people to businesses to make all their decisions, because environment affects everybody. And what we breathe is affects everyone. And 8 out of 10 deaths that you've already seen, a lot of data around it, but just one more number is that 8 out of 10 deaths can be attributed to air pollution. So it's a very big, massive problem, apart from it being a global climate killer. So we are in here to solve this problem. And I look forward to, I'll keep it short. I look forward to talking a lot more about our technology, what we do, or how we can collaborate if anybody is interested to do a research, to build a lot of solutions or products. We have the right kind of data, which is very hyper-local, down to every single street. More on our technology on indianairpollution.com or globalairpollution.com, where we track air pollution across 90 plus countries in the world, including in India, where we track air pollution for millions of streets, 1.5 lakh postcodes in India. So with that, I thank you very much for the opportunity, and I really hope we will see the NCAP. Few things that I think should happen is NCAP should be legally backed campaign, that they could enforce stringent policies, that data be made available, low-cost monitoring be adopted. We are one of the densest low-cost monitors across the country, and we're growing it by several hundreds in a few months to come. And we will be one of the largest network. And we're trying to solve the problem of data, combining on-ground sensing and satellite data and a lot of technology. So thank you so much for the opportunity, Ashish, and over to you. Thanks.
Thanks, Barry. And I think just a quick question, you know, from the start of curiousness. So, you know, all these data points that you're able to capture, not just within India, but across the globe, are these through local sensors that you've installed, or are there other ways of doing it?
Yes, we combine, you know, we're tracking up over 18,000 stations regularly, and this data is near real-time data, and over 7 satellites. Some of them are free, some of them are paid satellites. They are both geostationary and orbital satellite data. We're also, you know, using a few drone technologies. We capture a lot of data, not just from the sensors or satellites alone, but our data is very highly dependent on the factors that drive it. For example, traffic or population density or garbage burning or construction. you know, human activities like these, or even weather where you see smog in Delhi, or stubble burning and haze that carries forward, or the Indo-Gangetic plain that traps the air. All of these factors are trained into model. I mean, I'll go on technical details some other time. Since me being a CTO, I keep going back to that all the time. But then, yeah, to answer your question, that's how we track across the world.
That's really interesting, Mary. And I think I'll personally be in touch with you after this because I have a lot of questions. I'm a technical person as well. So generally, you know, love to know. And also, I think, how can we, you know, have more and more real-time tracking stations across the country? Because then I think the future is also predictive, where I think your AI might come in handy, wherein we're also able to predict the trends instead of just being able to tell what is happening right now. And so I think I'm just thinking out loud, maybe if that is the future or something is being done on those lines, wherein I could predict that, okay, just like I'm able to predict weather based on certain trends, and you know, we understand that waste burning could be a trend, traffic at certain time could be a trend. So if you could predict that, dust storms could be a trend and can be predicted through satellites again. So I think it's very, very interesting space to be in. So kudos to you and your team. And thank you so much for joining us on the webinar today. Now, what we'll do is, before we wrap it up, we have 10 more minutes and we'll take up a few questions. The questions are open. I'll request all the speakers to kindly turn on their videos. And anyone who feels appropriate can take up these questions that I'm going to put across. Questions have been shared by the audience themselves. So the first question here that's coming in is, it's very interesting. We have been hearing about car-free days in a lot of cities across the globe, especially Europe. So a lot of developed countries are now planning to go back to the ancient practices as car-free days to promote walking or cycling, which means, you know, we need infrastructure for that. Obviously, it reduces vehicular emissions. How far do you think is possible for India to implement such initiatives? So that's open for any one of you to address.
So I feel that we need to understand, because you know that when we are biking or we are walking on the road, so the our metabolic activities are, I think, higher. So that we need to understand how, because when we are doing this car-free day, what would be the emission rate reduction in terms of the car contribution? And that we need to first understand that, because this is a good initiative. Anyway, we have to start this kind of initiative. But I feel that we should start these type of initiative in the cities where we have a less pollution. You know, instead of the cities where we have the higher pollution and a more dense population. So I think we should start in the smaller cities where this office distance and all those distance are lesser than the bigger cities. So in that way we could start. But for the bigger cities, you know, that we may have this exposure timing, because when we are biking or like walking, we may inhale more toxic airs as compared to when we are in the car. But yeah, it's a good option.
Yeah, I think it has to be also, you know, in doing it in polluted cities is a tricky situation, because while people move to cycling or biking, it reduces pollution, but the pollution already is so high that it could really choke them, that even if they are, because I've seen literally people cycling with masks. Now that's lethal, right? Like you are literally choking yourself by wearing a mask and then cycling or working out. So I think, yes, definitely. And, you know, this, the non-urban side or the smaller cities, the tier 2 or tier 3 cities, are anyways closer to nature, and you know, they generally follow these practices a lot. It's all about making this a norm, promoting it, and then eventually making it a movement, so that, you know, the dependence on private vehicles and you know, the carbon emission goes down. So well said. And I think the next question that is coming in is, I could also add on to this. The question is that, is 100% ban on diesel generators possible when using in the emergency standby power source in specific to industries in Delhi NCR region? So, you know, what I personally think about this is, the entire purpose of having diesel generators as of now is uninterrupted power supply where it's needed and not in a regular scenario. So even when, you know, the emergency is declared on air pollution in Delhi NCR time and again, especially during winters, the diesel generators are still allowed for uninterrupted supply in places like hospitals, malls, you know, wherever you need 100% supply. At the same time, what I remember, I think the NCAP talks about either retrofitting these devices or moving to the gas-based generators. So whatever is unavoidable at the moment, so while the problem of 100% consistent supply gets solved, because if that is done, then you do not need DGs as a backup source. However, until that is done, the NCAP has given clear recommendations as to either you retrofit the device to capture the pollution at source or you transition to gas-based generators. If anyone wants to add anything to this, you know, I'm more than happy. Okay, great. So I think we're good with this one. This is now the next question that has come in is very similar to what we've already spoken about, that, you know, during the post-COVID, the entire focus is going to be on reviving the economy, which means the industry will double, triple the efforts to cover the lost economy that will be, you know, leading to more air pollution. What could be done on an urgent basis? Like, we have talked about policies, we have talked about solutions. Are there some things which are already being done or that could be done? What do you guys think? And I think having a couple of lines from all of you will be very important on this as to what are the measures that could be taken to prevent this counterproductive effort just for the heck of reviving the economy. Maybe Divya, you would like to go first and then we can have others coming in.
Yeah, so I think you know that we need to first understand, because industrial emission going to be high future, so I think after COVID-19 lockdown, so this is going to be happen, but I think we need to give some kind of responsibilities to the industries also. For example, I think people are going to use like biomass for cooking purpose, because migrant population, they are there, because we are working on Surat, and Surat, lots of migrant people go to the Surat city for the jobs. So I think we must give some kind of responsibility to industry. If you want to reduce emission from the production, so you could, I think you could get some kind of, do a kind of credit thing. So that's just provide the gas to law or some kind of electric heater to the migrant workers. So that could be a reduction. And also we could target some easier sectors like a waste burning. And also, because after this COVID-19 lockdown, there would be an increase in the biomass burning for the cooking, because of that many people lost their job, many people had there is income. So we need to think about those also, because not only industries, the other sectors is going to be affected, right? This COVID-19 lockdown. So we need to work in that.
Sure. I think Ria wants to say something. Ria, you are on mute.
I didn't realize I was on mute. I think it would be good, you know, we're seeing a lot of economic stimulus come out. And I think, you know, if we had an incentive, whether you were an SME or a large scale industry, basically, you know, to make it more measurable commitments, of clearing the air, of lower carbon economy, of just, you know, not regressing and actually, like I said, building back better and focusing some of our stimulus on that, I think that would be a good incentive.
That's a very good point. I think very similar to what I was with Sri B.K. Jindal, the director of software and mission last week. And he mentioned about something similar being done for waste management, wherein they are creating incentives for cities who are performing better. This way, there is a monetary incentive, and then we know that money moves the world. So I think that's also applied to the air quality maintenance. I think that's
important. So if I can add to that, are you able to hear me?
Yes, yeah, we can.
Yeah. So I think that's a very valid point. And if you take the example of the last financial crisis that we had, the countries which were able to, you know, use that as an opportunity to develop green sectors, you know, for instance, solar and batteries, like China, they've really, you know, sort of been able to leapfrog both domestically as well as been able to create a global market for their green products. So I think in this whole building back better, we should also think strategically on what are the areas that India can also become a global leader in products and use that as, you know, both for development as well as addressing environmental challenges. And there are a lot of opportunities for us to do so. Also, you know, I think if you look at opportunities, there are many. There is, for instance, a whole area of cold storage and cold chains, you know, for agricultural productivity and using renewable energy, clean energy for developing cold chain so that rural areas become more self-sufficient. Urban areas become more, this pandemic has shown us that supply chains can get, they're so vulnerable, they can get easily disrupted. How do you create infrastructure which is more resilient, more localized? And all that is also opportunity for jobs, opportunity for economic development at the local level, environmentally sustainable. So I think those are things that we need to think about. There's also a lot of conversation happening about, and I won't get into it, on this whole, disenchantment with neoliberalism and globalization and people wanting to go back to being local. So I won't get into that. But, there are all those conversations that we need to actually think strategically about now and what and how we can use these opportunities to build back better. And there are countries which are very proactively doing it. In Europe, the countries like Germany are very proactively integrating green and sustainability issues into their recovery packages. We need to take cue from these countries and think on similar lines. So if I may also take this opportunity to let you know, on 6th of July, we're having a webinar on exactly this issue of how India can integrate some of these aspects in the recovery package, in the stimulus package. And I'll be happy to share the invite to that webinar with all of you after this. Thanks.
Ashish, please feel free to share the webinar link with us. So when we send the post-event email, we can definitely send it out to all the attendees. I guess it will be of interest to a lot of them. And, these are interesting times because we have been asked to become Atmanirbhar, become local while driving Swachh Bharat and cleaning the air. So, there is a lot of hope. Again, I will not dwell a lot into that topic, but there is a long conversation that can happen. But today's discussion, makes, I think, a lot of us realize that, and one of the speakers had already mentioned that there is a lot of knowledge in our country. There are also solutions that exist. There are also people willing to get onto the ground and enforce this, talk about it, motivate people, sensitize people. But I think my personal experience has been where we need to do better is that we need to foster partnerships. I think all these people who are working in different fronts, I understand, especially a body like United Nations Environment Program is already doing a lot of partnerships in different cities. I think both from a solution standpoint to research institutions, to citizen groups, they need to be brought together because only when these efforts are aggregated is when we can drive quick actions. Otherwise, in their own silos, they kind of get missed out or are unheard. And I think if we really want to make and drive that impact, we'll all have to be together in that fight and not just the six of us who are talking, but also everyone who's hearing and, more than 1,000 people who have seen this on the Facebook live webinar already. So that's what I feel. And I think one final question that we could take up, and that's for you, Ria. One person asked that, and that question comes up all the time when you talk about a product. Are these home compostable or do they require us special environment for composting?
No, that's why I said I want home compostable. That was the whole idea, Ashish, because when I set up to compete, you're very aware that we still don't have formal waste segregation or like waste management systems. And the last thing I wanted to do was create something that ended up in our ever-growing landfills. So the idea is that we use biomass, it's a whole waste to wealth concept. There are no additives, binders, etc. And once you put it in soil, it turns into soil in a period of 90 to 100 days. And it's all certified. So, you could visit our website and have a look at all our certification. It's all there.
That's awesome. Pleased to hear that. And I'm sure, more and more people are going to advocate for that. So any concluding thoughts? It's open for all of you. If you want to put in, my concluding thoughts, I've already put across. I feel partnerships and coming together is the way to go. But if we just spend 30 seconds each very quickly because the time is over, but would like to hear the concluding thoughts. Prathana had to leave because she had a scheduled call at 4:30. She's already mentioned. But for the four of you, if you could just take 30 seconds each and put in the concluding thought for the way forward. We cannot hear you.
There you go. So I agree with you. I think alignment and collaboration is key. I think a lot of us are doing a lot of great work in different silos, and I think we all need to come together. And I think the second thing is that I would love as a nation not to have a knee-jerk reaction to this. We're all aware of it. We've lived through it. We're breathing it. You know, and we've now got the opportunity where we've had this reset and we can think strategically and actually work on a clean slate and make a difference. So, you know, that's my hope. So, yeah.
I think for me, please go ahead.
No, please go ahead. I'm coming after you.
So I think for me, I think, you know, that as I already mentioned, that there is a lot of knowledge and people willing to just do something for the air quality. But I think we have some constraint on the ground also. So I think India needs to, identify the easy to tough solution, and we need to work accordingly. There are some sectors which are easy and easier, and they have multiple benefits and the local solutions. So I think we need to go in that way, so that because in that way we would be able to solve the problem. Otherwise, I feel that because I walk on the ground, there could be a lot of difficulty in the future for the air pollution. And I feel that at least India would take at least 20 to 30 years to give us the clean air. That's what I think is.
Yeah, my last final thought would be that we really have to, you know, when we plan an intervention, we really have to stop seeing that there is a trade-off between development and environment. And I think that's the way we need to plan and prioritize. And I think that's the one big lesson that this pandemic has taught us. If you look at the origins of the pandemic, it's very clear that it's come from the fact that we've degraded nature, we've sort of encroached on, you know, areas which were for other species, or, you know. So I think the lessons are very clear. It's a complicated web of life. We are a part of it, and we shouldn't see a trade-off between environment and development. Our developmental priorities, policies need to integrate environment into center stage. I think in that's the main takeaway. And though it may sound very generic, but I think it's something which, as a principle, if we adopt, we will be able to deliver on. You know, if it becomes a touchstone for all our policies, then it is something which can be integrated into our policy making. And that's what we really need to do, because we're already seeing, for instance, now with in the reform package, the opening up of the coal sector, huge sort of going back to coal. And we're not hearing so much about renewable energy in the whole recovery package. So I think, you know, I mean, we need to question some of these and have some key principles on which to measure our own policies and programs, and keeping long-term implications in view. Thanks.
Yeah, and I just want to add that, you know, there is still so much scope for innovation, adoption of technology, carbon capture storage practices, helping industries get on a carbon neutrality roadmap, improving the cap and trade policy, allowing NCAP to be legally backed, and, you know, ensure certain extension of policies across the world. Like we've seen how construction is, you know, there was a recent news where a few builders were fined for polluting because of construction. In Noida, that was one of the firsts. I think we want to see more of those, be it open road to building construction that could control a lot of dust, stubble burning and whole lot of things. Something on ground, I've been doing some work around this locally. But I think in the areas of Northern Indo, Gangetic Plain, there is a lot of scope for educating the better methods to do so and subsidizing those farmers to do certain things. Could, I think, reduce 30-40% straight away of pollution in those regions. So some of these things, adoption of technology is one of definitely the factors that every policymaker, to enforcer, to follower, should look at adoption.
Thank you so much, everyone, for sharing your concluding thoughts. And what I feel is that whatever we do, every activity should be driving all the three things in parallel, which is social welfare, environmental upgradation, and economy boost. Only that will be sustainable. And yes, you know, time and again, we have done trade-offs, and that's why we are in the situation we are in today, where we don't have clean water, we don't have clean air to breathe, and we are going through the first pandemic of our lifetimes at least, and hoping that another one does not come over the next few decades. But for that, a lot of integrated action is needed. And today, whatever thoughts we have put in together, I think they're just the initiation of a discussion, possible partnerships that we all could explore and work together in solving this problem. So once again, thank you so much for taking out these 90 minutes. And I'm sure everyone benefited a lot from this insightful conversation. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you for organizing, Ashish. Thanks.
Thanks, Ashish. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Ashish. Bye-bye. Thanks.